Welcome to NPTEL's MOOC on Computer Architecture. So as part of this module, I'm going to discuss the overview of Computer Architecture course, and we define what is Computer Architecture, and so what is the syllabus we cover, and what are the reference books, and so on. So before defining the Computer Architecture, so I would like to explain the layered view of computer design. If you see a computer design in a layered view, there are several layers starting from the application layer and all the way up to transistor layer. And each of these layers specifies a set of operations. And for example, if you consider an application layer, so it talks about the type of applications that run on a computer. In general, a computer can run any application and so on, but in reality, when we design a computer, we design a computer for specific purposes. For example, if you consider a supercomputer, our target applications for supercomputer are high-end applications, which are the weather modeling, molecular simulations, and etc. On the other hand, if we consider a desktop computer, our target applications are email, word processing, and etc. So depending on the type of applications for which we want to design a computer, we need to define our requirements, and we tune our designs for optimizing those requirements. After this application layer, the next layer is algorithmic layer. So in the algorithmic layer, typically once the application is defined, now we need to see what are the characteristics of the applications, such as what type of data this application takes, what type of operations we can perform, how the operations sequencing happen, and is there any implicit parallelism among the operations. We have to define all these things, and once we define these things, the next step is to come up with the step-by-step procedure to compute the outputs for the application. So once the algorithmic layer is completed, effectively, like, we have an algorithm, the next one is we need to translate this algorithm into a high-level programming language. Effectively, we code this algorithm into a high-level programming language such as C, C++, Java, or Fortran. Once we code a high-level program, the next step is we need to run this high-level program on the computer. But to run that, we need operating system layer, which effectively specifies the system software, which include operating systems, compilers, linkers, assemblers, and so on. So these are the actual routines which help executing our high-level program on the real hardware. And the next comes the architecture layer. So this architecture layer specifically describes the instruction set architecture. This instruction set architecture is nothing but the set of the instructions, instruction formats, operands, addressing modes, so I/O mechanisms, memory model, and all these things. And once we have an ISA, our system software level, especially the compiler, converts the program into the machine understandable form by using this ISA. To this architecture level, all the other layers are actually corresponds to hardware, and all the layers above architecture layer corresponds to the software. In other words, the architecture layer is the interface between the software and hardware. Once ISA is defined, our next task is to have the functional units which execute the instructions specified by ISA, and that comes in microarchitecture layer. In other words, microarchitecture, or also called as organization, deals with the functional units and the interconnection among these functional units to realize the ISA specified at the architecture layer. And once a microarchitecture layer is defined, the next one is the logic layer, which actually consists of digital circuits, both combinational and sequential circuits. And the components in the logic layer are the flip-flops and gates. Using these flip-flops and gates, we build digital circuits, both combinational and the sequential circuits. And the last layer is the transistor layer, which actually consists of the transistors, resistors, capacitors, and all these are used to build the gates and the transistors. So effectively, if you see this, the layered view of computer design, except the application layer, all other layers implement the layer above. For example, a transistor layer implements whatever is available at the logic layer, and the logic layer implements whatever is defined at the microarchitecture layer, and microarchitecture layer defines, implements whatever is there in architecture layer, and so on. So because our course is on computer architecture, we mainly focus on two layers. Those are architecture layer and microarchitecture layer. So having discussed this layered view of computer design, now we'll define what is a computer architecture. The computer architecture defines mainly the functionality or functional requirements of a computer that we want to design, which is specified by the instruction set architecture. Next one is the organization, or also called as a microarchitecture, which is nothing but the interconnection of functional units to realize ISA. And finally, the efficient implementation. How do we define one implementation is efficient? So to do that, first of all, we need to see what are the classes of computers, because depending on the type of the class of computer, our efficiency metric can be different. If you see different classes of computers, we have personal mobile devices, desktop computers, servers, and embedded computers. And each of these computers have different functional requirements, and they need to be designed for optimizing different metrics and so on. If you consider, for instance, personal mobile devices, here the main important thing is the responsiveness and the predictiveness. And because these personal mobile devices are operated using battery, so our main design requirement is energy efficiency. When we want to design a personal mobile device, we have to design in such a way that the energy efficiency is improved. On the other hand, if you consider servers, because the servers are used by multiple users simultaneously to execute their programs and so on, so here the requirement, functional requirements are availability and the scalability. And because these are multiple users are using, so when we design a server type of system, we have to design the system to optimize the throughput, and similarly for the other type of the computers. The Flynn's classification of computer architectures, there are four groups of computer architectures, starting with SISD, single instruction and single data stream. So we have instructions are taken from a single instruction stream, and then these instructions are operated on single data stream. And here, typically, we exploit the instruction level parallelism among the instructions of the program. And the example processors or computers belong to this class of computer architecture or uniprocessor systems. The next class of computer architecture is SIMD, single instruction and multiple data. Here we have instructions from a single instruction stream, but these instructions are operated on multiple data streams. Effectively, we can exploit the parallelism available at the data level. And the example systems that belong to this class of computer architecture are vector architectures, array processors, GPUs, multimedia extensions, and so on. And the third class of computer architecture is MISD, multiple instructions and single data stream. But actually this class of computer architecture is defined just for the completeness sake, but there is no commercially viable implementation of systems belong to this particular class. And the last class of computer architecture is MIMD, multiple instructions and multiple data. Here instructions are taken from multiple instruction streams and these can be operated on multiple data streams simultaneously. So effectively we can exploit parallelism available at thread level. And the example systems that belong to this class of computer architecture are multi-core processors. Having defined the computer architecture and discussed the various classes of computer architectures and so on, now we are going to discuss the course objectives. By the way, in this course we mainly focus on two classes of computer architectures. One is SISD, single instruction single data stream, and the second one is multiple instruction and multiple data streams. Effectively we will consider a unicore processor systems as well as multi-core processor systems and discuss the internals in detail. So the main objectives of the course are threefold. We discuss mainly the fundamentals of computer architecture, because understanding the fundamentals of computer architecture helps in building the efficient computer systems and so on. And next we'll discuss in detail the understanding of the superscalar processor design, because if you consider any of the current day multi-core processors, each of the individual cores are internally designed as superscalar processors. Here in this part we discuss how out-of-order execution happens and how dynamic execution happens and so on. And finally, the third objective of the course is to provide an overview on multi-core processors, especially issues related to multi-core processors such as cache coherency, synchronization and memory consistency. So this course is a 20-hour lecture course, and we consider the syllabus for this course like this: 1 week of lectures on instruction set principles, 2 weeks of lectures on memory hierarchy design, specifically concentrating on cache memory design and DRAM based memory design, and 1 week of lectures on understanding the fundamentals of pipelining, issues related to pipelining such as pipeline hazards and how to resolve those pipeline hazards, and 2 weeks of lectures on exploiting instruction level parallelism available in SISD type of computer architectures. And in this the section we also discuss the out of order execution, superscalar processors, dynamic scheduling and all the other things. And finally, the last 2 weeks of the course we discuss exploiting thread level parallelism, especially discussing things related to multi-core architecture. So for this course we use these three reference books: Computer Architecture, A Quantitative Approach by Hennessy and Patterson, and Modern Processor Design, Fundamentals of Superscalar Process. Especially this is for understanding the internals of superscalar process, and this is by Shen and Lipasti. And third one is for especially for DRAM based memory design, we consider Memory Systems book by Jacobs, Spencer and Wang. So with this brief overview, I would like to stop this module. Thank you.